Okay, so now I got a little bit of feedback, and my feeling is that one part of the audience is extremely familiar with this language and the another part not at all, and maybe another third is in the middle. I mean, I did, of course, didn't talk to everybody. So why don't we do it this way? Those who are interested in this base change, and I can tell you it's the heart of the story, it is just requires a complicated language, maybe. I can explain this in much detail in the tutorial. So whoever is interested in this, please come to the tutorial, and I will explain more on that. Okay. And you can also ask questions, then we have a lot of time. Anyway, you can ask me questions anytime. Otherwise, let me quickly say the subtlety I wanted to mention for a module of a conformal field theory of a vertex algebra, you want it to be local. This means if you move one field of your VOA around the field of the module, then you don't want it to pick up any phase. You want it to have trivial monodromy. We call this locality. It's the natural word for it, right? The space change does not necessarily map a local module to a local module. So this is the big subtlety of the construction. However, luckily, if my theory is nice, so that Wallin's formula holds, then I can use Wallin's formula to check this locality. So I put this in the lecture notes how it goes, and I gave an exercise on it. But maybe I don't know. Do you want me to explain this, or do you prefer to go to examples immediately? Any opinion?
Examples.
Okay. So and I will actually also then explain this issue in the example that will come. Okay. So. We can extend a VOA, or we can go to a sub-VOA. From now on, we will go to a sub-VOA, to a sub-algebra. The easiest way to do is if we have a non-trivial automorphism group, then we can just look at the sub-VOA that is invariant under the action of these automorphisms. And we call this then the orbifold theory. So let G be a group of V automorphisms then the theory invariant under G, so we call it V with a superscript G, is called the orbifold VOA, or the G orbifold VOA. So if we let's assume that G acts semi-simply on V. We usually assume that.
So in the CFT context, are you assuming that your W algebras at least contain some Virasoro algebra, and probably also that the group of automorphisms preserves the Virasoro algebra, or you don't assume
that? I don't need it here yet. So I mean, I don't need it to assume it yet. Of course, I want always to assume. Well, actually, one can solve important, very interesting problems if one better does not assume it, but I will not explain this in these lectures. So for these lectures, we assume, of course, it leaves a Virasoro vector invariant. Yes?
So are we taking the elements which are themselves invariant under G, or is it a subalgebra like stable under the action of G?
No, it's the ones that are invariant under the action of G. So. Especially if we take our big VOA V, then it decomposes into modules of our subalgebra and of our group, and so we can write it as a module for finite, let's say, finite dimensional representation of our group, and then multiplicity spaces, and so these are modules for the group. And these are modules for the orbifold VOA. Okay. And there's one thing one can say, namely the following. Under all the assumptions that I don't want to mention, so under the assumption that the orbifold theory is physically reasonable, one has the following. One has, if the tensor product of G modules is of the, let's say, the tensor product of G modules is given by certain structure constants of this type, then the tensor product of V modules is of the same type. So, in some sense, I mean, what this is saying is just by just the orbifold decomposition already gives us fusion rules for free. They are just group-like. They are just the same fusion rules as in this representation ring of G modules. Okay, so that this is something the orbifold gives you for free, certain fusion rules.
Would it be possible to see maybe an example starting from the free boson or something like that?
Yes. So let's do an example of a free field algebra. Yes. Who has a question? Yes.
Sorry, just before you do the example, could you explain why you can decompose V into this way? It's not completely obvious to me why you can write it as a V module with a VG module.
Yeah. So the question is, why can I do this? And so I assume that G acts semi-simple on V. So that means it's a direct sum of G modules coming with some multiplicity, and the multiplicity is usually an infinite dimensional vector space. And the orbifold VUA acts on this, and this is then a fairly deep, well, okay, I'm not sure how deep it is. It's a classical theorem due to Hauer that one can do this decomposition. So this is not an obvious statement by no means, but it's again a statement that actually comes from classical algebra.
I think in your lecture notes, rather than V, you have a V module M.
Oh, I didn't look at my notes, my notation there. Yeah, did I write M?
Yeah, I think it was a V module, right, rather than V itself.
Oh, that's correct. It just when I take a V module, then it's harder to say something about the fusion rules. So you were asking what happens if I take a V module. If I take a V module, I have a similar type of decomposition. It's just that I cannot do this conclusion for the fusion rules.
Okay, so that is the decomposition of V itself, the VOA.
Yeah, this is the decomposition of the VOA itself, okay. Yes. Let me do an example. So for example, we take now our vector space that carries an action of our favorite Lie group. So for example, what do we know? We know that C2 carries an action of SU2, right? So that means I can now take my favorite free field algebra associated to C2. So consider the you know, I prefer to take C2 plus C2, two copies of the standard representation, because I want to have a non-degenerate invariant pairing. Consider the free boson on two copies of the standard representation of SL2 with a bilinear form, just the pairing. We take a basis from this one, so we take a basis V1, V2, here a basis W1, W2, and then and then the pairing would be B of VI with WJ is just delta IJ. Just that's, for example, how you can take it. Okay. Now this vector space has an SU2 action, and that lifts to an action on the Heisenberg VUA just by acting correspondingly on the fields for corresponding to these vectors. So you think about, means we have here our column vectors, and instead of having column vectors, we have here our field X1, our first and our second Heisenberg field. And so then we have a clear SU2 action on that. And then this big Heisenberg VOA, you can take the SU2 orbifold, and it decomposes in such a way just that, there's no use in writing down an explicit formula here, because I cannot, there's not much to say about these modules. It's just these vectors that carry the standard representation of SU2, so that's the action of SU2 on it. That's the action.
Maybe you could say, for if you just take a Z2 orbifold.
Yes, let's do a Z2 orbifold.
We can of course also take a Z2 orbifold, just changing the mapping every Heisenberg field to its to minus it one. You're right, this is of course better, and for this we can just take a single free boson. We don't need to take many of them, and then we have our Heisenberg free boson, and this free boson VOA decomposes now in the even part. That means that is invariant under this action, plus the odd part. And what do we see from this one? These are even degree, normally ordered polynomials. In X and their derivative, and here it is odd degree. So here we see if we compare it with this formula, we should say it's just a I mean just a Z mod a 2Z. So here it comes with a trivial representation, and here the odd representation of C2. Yeah. Twisted sectors is then something different, because we go to a smaller algebra. So this would be our our orbifold VOA. And it's a smaller one. So if you have you have a smaller structure, it can have more modules, so less restrictive. And the twisted modules are ordinary modules for the even part. It's just then, if you do base change to the bigger one, they are not local modules for the bigger one, but twisted ones. So, right, so, yeah.
Maybe you can say in terms of strings or some geometric picture what twisted module means.
Right, so you like to think about a boson, compactified on a circle or so, twisted means that you catch a phase if you move it once around your circle, and what it means in terms of a nice way to see it is if you take a twisted module, then as a module for the bigger one for V, it is not integer graded anymore. That's what twisted maybe also could also be seen as what it means, and this implies that the grading of the modes of the Heisenberg of the free boson algebra on this module is not integer graded anymore, but half integer graded. Okay. Now the question one wants to ask is what kind of W algebra is an orbifold theory? And then one passes to a classical invariant theory. Let's do an example. Yeah, this is VG.
Okay, only that.
Yes.
And the other one, what is it?
That's a module for VG. Let's go back to this example, okay? Now we would like to understand what kind of W algebra is this. And so this means what kind of fields do I need? And these have, of course, to be normally ordered polynomials in the free boson, such that they strongly generate this orbifold VOA. So now we have to think about what could possibly be SU2 invariant if I take copies of the standard representation. So for the VOA, now you should think about, all the fields live in the standard representations, their derivatives as well, their second derivatives, third derivatives, and et cetera. And so then the normally ordered product of such fields lives then in the tensor product of the standard representation with itself, and so on. So really we are asking, what are the SU2 invariants in the tensor ring of the standard representation of SU2. So what kind of SU2 invariants can I build out of iterated tensor products of representations of SU2, standard representation of SU2 with itself? Well, let's take just a tensor product of the standard representation with itself. What does it give us? It gives us the adjoint and the trivial representation, right? Just think about the tensor product as a 2x2 matrix. Then we have the diagonal, that's a singlet, it's an invariant under SU2, and then the adjoint. And it turns out that these are all the invariants in the SU2 case, that's not true. If you replace SU by U2, then these are all. Okay. So let me just write down a few invariants. So what do we have now? We have our Heisenberg fields x1, x2, y1, and y2. Each of them you should think about as a column vector or a row vector, whatever you prefer, on which SU2 acts. And then and then an invariant would be just the trace. For example, x1 times y1 plus x2 times y2. This would be invariant under SU2. Or more generally, I can take a derivative, for example, of x1, of the x's. And that would also be an invariant. Or more general, I take any derivative of the x1s and any derivative of the y's. I always mean normal ordered product, yes. And let's maybe replace SU2 by U2, because then these are all invariants. And this is, if you take the book by Weil, Classical Invariant Theory, beginning of last century, he tells you that these are all invariants. So this means these give us a strong generating set of the VOA. It's, of course, not an optimal set because these are infinitely many. But at least something Classical Invariant Theory gives us already immediately. However, Classical Invariant Theory also tells us that there are certain relations between these traces. And then what one can do, and this is a very tricky business, is to show how these relations give relations on the VOA, because one has to think about what normally ordering corrections do. And the upshot is that one can use Classical Invariant Theory to show that one only needs finitely many of these traces, and it's a certain number. Okay, so and so this means what one can do is so one can use Classical Invariant Theory. Determine the minimal number and so I didn't write down the result for this one, but an example that I know is if you take if I take C2n, which I can view, it has an action of SP2n, and I can take here symplectic fermions. On this vector space, then it turns out that this orbifold theory, then the SP2n orbifold is of type W2, 4, 6, and so on up to 2n. So it has only very few strong generators. They are also all of such a trace type, and one can then show that one only needs a finite number of those. For especially in the very simplest case, n equals 1, SP2 is just SU2, and so then n is 1, we just get W2, we just get the Virasoro algebra as the SP2 orbifold of symplectic fermions, and this is the famous, it is at central charge minus 2, so it's a very famous example, actually.
Are all orbifolds W algebras? Is this a common...
That's a very good question. The question is whether all orbifolds are W algebras, and that is really the theme of these lectures. So I'll come to that question later. The answer is nobody knows, but it looks like very positive. Any other questions?
Why did you pick symplectic fermions as an example?
because it leads to a nice coset example.
If you would do normal Bosons or normal fermions, what
would happen? Similar results. Just fermions are fermions, they spare to zero. I mean, that means it's easier to get relations. If you take a similar thing with boson, you would have more strong generators. It's also why I didn't write this one down, because the W algebra would have, it would be of a much bigger type. So in general, this is a rule. If I take fermions, then the orbifold is kind of better behaved. But I took this example because I now want to go to cosets, and we want to think as orbifolds as classical limit kind of coset theories. And so, and we want to think about that orbifolds can already answer. Orbifolds one should take as much simpler as cosets, and orbifolds can already answer us questions for cosets. So we want to use them as a tool to understand cosets better. So now, any more questions? So I have to tell you what a coset is. Well, I replace G by a VOA. So we take now W to be a sub VOA of a bigger VOA V, and then the coset of V by W is, let me write it suggestively, V to the W, that is the subalgebra invariant under W. And in physics, one usually writes it as a quotient, which maybe explains the name coset. That's the notation. So really, if you look back to the definition of an orbifold, what I'm saying here is, if I have some algebraic structure acting on my VOA, and of course a sub-VOA acts on it, then if this action is nice enough, then the subspace that is invariant under this action, so subspace invariant means as a vector space, this coset is just the set of vacuum vectors for the subalgebra. That's what it means to be invariant. This can be given, this inherits a vertex algebra structure from the big one, and this one is the coset. So, so that's the definition. And while orbifolds are kind of restrictive, you can maybe nicely study orbifolds of free field algebras. Cosets give you rich zoos of new and interesting theories. And it might very well be that your big VOA is rather simple. Nonetheless, your coset might be a fairly complicated object to study. So what do I want to tell you? We want now to ask the basic question, what type of algebra is this coset? So what kind of fields generated? Because we always like to understand its spin content. And what can I say about the representation theory of this coset? And for that, I need the base change again. But I will try to do it very explicitly. Let's see. Yeah, please. Thank you. Oh, yes?
Just one question. So, in process theory, you have three vertex algebras, BW and proportion.
Yes.
So, which of them can contain the result? Because, I imagine if V and W both contain the result, then these are proportion cells.
Yeah.
Yeah,
so the question is, which of them contains Virasoro? Well, first of all, the coset algebra is also a subalgebra, so I can also take the coset of the big VOA by the coset VOA. What will I get? I will maybe get W, maybe an extension of W. So this means, in some sense, the notation of coset is a symmetric notation, because if I have a subalgebra, I can take its coset, but the coset the coset by the coset algebra gives the original subalgebra usually back, sometimes one that is a little bit bigger. So let me write this down. Then it's hopefully clearer. So let's call C for coset the VOA that is invariant under a subalgebra. Then what it follows is that the coset of V, so this is especially a subalgebra as well. And what does it have? It is W is a subalgebra of this one. Okay, and maybe one important statement. C and W, I mean a definition, are called mutually commuting in the big VOA if the coset of V by the coset is equal to W. So if we don't have not only inclusion but even equality. And this situation is the one you usually want to study. It also most often happens anyway. But from this point of view, so imagine we have a situation, we take a Westermeier-Witten theory, we take the Westermeier-Witten theory corresponding to subalgebra, then the coset will usually be some kind of W algebra. But conversely, we could also take the coset of the big Westermeier-Witten theory by this W algebra, and it would just be the Westermeier-Witten theory of the subalgebra. So they are really on an equal footing. No. It just comes from history. So algebraically, the good notation would be V with a superscript W, because it's the invariant one. It's just that they come historically from gauged Westermeier-Witten models, which you think about conformal field theory defined on some quotient of your Lie group. Okay. So now the point is, if I know V well, I know W well, then base change tells me that I know C well. And I think I should explain it in an example instead of in generality. So in the lecture notes I have written down, I have sketched how this works in general, and I would be very happy to explain it more, say in the tutorial if anybody likes, but I also don't have to. But let me tell you an example, and tell you in this example what properties the general theory tells us immediately. So what statements we get for free from the general theory of base change for VOAs. So example. So example. What do we do? We take SU2 at level k at times SU2 at level 1. And this carries a diagonal action of SU2 at level k plus 1. You just take the sum of your currents. The level is then additive, so it adds up to k plus 1. And this coset, in the first place, it's very well known. It's Virasoro at a certain central charge. And this central charge is that just the difference of the central charge of the numerator and denominator theory.
Can you explain why this is true, that the central charge is just the difference of the central charges?
Because if you take the difference of the Virasoro vectors, then it you can explicitly check using the commutation relations that it is invariant.
And we check this, I think, because I wouldn't understand from this definition
the definition of what I can check. Yeah, I don't want to check that now. As we can do that as an exercise. Okay. How to do what?
How to do this calculation, just in words, so don't do it.
This calculation?
Yes.
I'll come to this in the later lectures, and this is extremely difficult. I mean, not this case, but to understand it in whole generality. So proving statements like this is very hard, not in this case, because it's just the Virasoro. But this is exactly what I want to come to, how to understand what this is. This is really the whole point of the whole lectures, how to understand statements like, this must be Virasoro. Okay?
Somehow the old people in the 80s, they didn't know fancy stuff, like they just did some stupid calculation.
Yes, so what the people in the 80s did is they did an explicit computation, which shows you that Virasoro is contained, and a character argument that there's nothing else. Right? So really everything else they did was just conjectures based on computations and based on intuition or coincidences. But this is really what I want to tell you, that there's an efficient way, and this is by combining orbifold theory and intuition with fancy techniques to actually determine what such a coset theory is. Okay. Now, what can we do now? We can take a module of spin n of the first SU2 times a module of spin m of the second one. So let me give it a superscript k and 1 to indicate that it corresponds to the SU2 at level k and SU2 at level 1. And then what must happen? It must be a module for SU2 at level k plus 1 times a module for, I mean, it must be a module for the tensor product of these two VOAs. So what is this? The formula for this decomposition is the following. Here, what I assumed is that K is corresponds to a Westermino-Witten theory. And so these are modules of SU2 at level K, SU2 at level 1, SU2 at level K plus 1, and Virasoro modules we learned from Sylvain have two weight labels. And let me also be consistent with his notation. I have to put a 1 here. That's okay. So this is a computation one can do to realize this. And now, what I want to is.
In view of time, you should sort of try to conclude a bit now for this lecture, at least I think.
Is it already?
Okay. I think so. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Sure.
Find a good place to stop and pick up.
Okay. Sure. So Give me maybe not for five more minutes, because I want to say something about this example. I can maybe then go back at the beginning of next lecture to it. You observed in the lectures by Sylvang and by Lorenz that the fusion rules of SU2 and Virasoro are the same. This is an immediate consequence of this coset decomposition, because the same statement as I presented for the Orbi folds, namely remember, for the Orbi folds, I told you the big VOA decomposes as a direct sum of S modules for G times Orbi fold VOA, and the fusion rules of the Orbi fold VOA modules are the same as the fusion rules of the modules for the group. The same type of statement applies here. This means, if I take here especially the decomposition of the big VOA, then this corresponds to both indices here, spin labels to be zero. Then it says that the Virasoro modules, where the second label is zero, have precisely the same fusion rules as these SL2 modules. So this is a consequence you get immediately from the coset decomposition. And you see this is very rich, because you have heard that computing fusion rules is a very difficult statement. And then you get another statement for free, and that is the base change. That will say that the fusion rules of Virasoro, if I set this label to zero, are the same as the fusion rules of the VOA upstairs. And this is what I maybe will start explaining next lecture. So next lecture, what I will do is I will restart from here, write this example down again, and then carefully write down the fusion rules of SU2, of Virasoro, of this SU2, of this Virasoro, of this SU2. We compare fusion rules. I'll tell you what base change does, and we see explicitly that base change indeed respects tensor product. So this means this coset theorem explains to you the observation of Sylvang and Lorenz that fusion rules of SU2 and Virasoro are kind of the same, and it hopefully illustrates how powerful this concept is. I mean, here we only reproduce something known, but later in the lecture we will get completely new results in that way. Okay.